Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents First Class Teaching, 10 Lessons You Don't Learn in College, by Michelle Emerson, narrated by Wendy Tremont King. Introduction. You're hired. How's it going in here? I was standing on a chair in the middle of my classroom, trying to hang tissue paper lanterns, using a paper clip to wedge the string between the light fixture and ceiling tile, when I heard a voice coming from my doorway. It's worth mentioning that I'm only 5'3" on a good day, so I had the added obstacle of standing on my tippy toes and still barely reached the ceiling. I delicately turned around and braced myself to be scolded by whoever this was at my door, because I was almost certainly committing either an OSHA violation, fire code violation, or both. I caught a glimpse of her face and instantly knew she looked familiar, but couldn't remember who she was or where I had seen her before. Did she work in the front office? Was she the librarian? The past 2 weeks since I was hired as a first-year teacher had been an absolute whirlwind, and I was still trying to catch my breath. I had attended more meetings than I could count and left each one more confused than when I went in. I had met and shook hands with dozens of my new coworkers, only to forget their names seconds later. She smiled at me, but waited patiently for my answer before saying anything else. Honestly, I don't know what I'm doing and feel like I'm going to throw up, but other than that, I'm great. Humor. This was and still is my coping mechanism when I feel uncomfortable. Well, let us know if you need anything from us. My joke obviously didn't land. In that moment of failed comedy, I realized who she was. I had just told my assistant principal, who had hired me 2 weeks ago, that I had no idea what I was doing. Crap! I could feel the blood rushing to my face as she disappeared from my doorway. Surely headed back to her office to call HR and tell them she had made a huge mistake when she hired me. Ms. Ferre? Well, that was fast. I was standing directly under the intercom speaker and could practically feel the sound waves vibrating throughout my entire body. This was it. This would be my last moment as a teacher. Yes? We're making an adjustment to your class list. We are moving a student to another second grade class just to balance things out. Check your email for the updated roster. Click. The intercom cut off. And I could finally process everything that had just transpired in the past 30 seconds. Let's see. I told my assistant principal I wanted to throw up. Not my best moment, but not my worst. I still had a class list, which meant I still had a job. Wonderful. A wave of relief washed over me, but was quickly replaced with an even stronger feeling of humiliation. I knew what balance things out was code for. I was new, but I wasn't stupid. I was hired at 20 years old as a first-year teacher with no real classroom experience besides my student teaching internship, which was glorified hand-holding. Word had gotten out to parents in the community that I was inexperienced, and they were requesting to move their children out of my class. Ouch. Don't get me wrong. I expected to receive pushback as a new teacher. I anticipated the questions, the concerns, and the doubt from parents, because I was feeling the exact same skepticism toward myself. Unfortunately, that didn't make it sting any less. I had exactly 1 week to pick my pride up off the floor, somehow discover my non-existent confidence, and step into the spotlight in my classroom. Showtime. Good morning. I'm Ms. Ferre, and I'm going to be your second grade teacher this year. I'm so excited you're in my class." I had rehearsed these opening lines in my head about 100 times, as if I was preparing to give an acceptance speech for an award. Spoiler alert, my first day of teaching was definitely not an Oscar-worthy performance. Despite my best effort, the words escaped my mouth jumbled and nervy as I greeted students on the first day of school. It worked in my favor, or so I thought, that most of the students were every bit as nervous as I was, so they funneled in and took their seats quietly, while I aimlessly bounced around the room like a pinball that desperately needed some bumpers for guidance. "I don't feel so good." A small boy was walking toward me with both of his arms wrapped tightly around his stomach. I recognized his picture from the class list and remembered he was the boy who just transferred from another school within the county. "You're probably just feeling nervous because it's the first day of school. Here, let me show you your desk and help you My fake it until you make it teaching mentality may not have been in the running for any Oscar nominations, but I truly believe this singular moment should have won an Academy Award for Best Live-Action Short Film. I was 15 minutes into my first day of teaching. My shoes were now covered in vomit, more on that in a later chapter, and no less than 10 different emotions had swept across my face in a matter of seconds. It was truly an incredible performance. I took an imaginary bow in my head, while my audience of wide-eyed second graders eagerly awaited the next scene. I prayed for some movie magic as I looked at the clock and desperately hoped it read 3:45 so I could go home. Nope. 9 o'clock. The day wasn't a wrap. But it was time to take my students to art, and I welcomed the opportunity to collect myself. I could handle this. I guided my students into something that resembled a line, and we chaotically entered the hallway. The line leader followed my directions through the maze of classrooms until we arrived at what I thought was the art room. But why were the lights off? My students waited patiently against the wall while I double-checked the placard outside the door. Art. It said art. I peeked my head through the doorway and quickly scanned the room. A feeling of pure panic washed over me as I realized there were no paint palettes or brushes, and more importantly, there was no art teacher. I reluctantly returned to my former line that now resembled a squiggle of students and decided to improvise. "We're a little early, so we are just going to practice walking in the hallway for a bit." I had bought myself time, but sadly, my next move was still a mystery. My eyes darted around as I nervously began leading my class along the colored tile floor without a destination in sight. After what felt like an eternity of aimless walking, I finally made eye contact with another staff member who, thankfully, must have either seen the look of terror plastered all over my face or been able to smell my fear, because she stopped to help me without drawing too much attention. We exchanged a few whispers, and she informed me that the art room had been moved to a portable classroom in the fenced area outside of the main school building. In other words, the exact last place I would have looked for it. She deserved a standing ovation for her performance as best supporting role in the horror film that was my first day of teaching. Behind the scenes. Like a fish out of water, suddenly I was a teacher fresh out of college, and I was terrified to admit I felt more out of place than I ever could have imagined. When I was studying all the educational theories and best teaching practices while earning my degree, everything made sense. I had attended all the lectures, created detailed lesson plans, gotten hundreds of hours of hands-on experience in real classrooms, worked with incredible mentor teachers, and answered questions well enough in my interview to be hired for my current role. In theory, I was ready to be a teacher. But the moment I stepped foot into my own classroom, I struggled to put what I had learned into practice. It was like giving a student basic directions that were confidently acknowledged as understood with a thumbs up, only to have the student immediately forget everything you just told her when she returned to her seat to actually start the assignment. Except, I was the confused student in this situation instead of the teacher. The issue wasn't the knowledge or understanding, it was the execution. Most of the strategies you learn in college are designed for ideal circumstances. But real-life classrooms are far from textbook. This leaves you feeling inadequate, defective, and defeated when you try to implement them, but no matter how hard you try, they aren't working. You feel as if you are the reason the strategies are failing, when in actuality, the strategies are vague, outdated, and not easily applicable to a variety of situations. But regardless of the reasoning, the realities aren't matching your expectations, and your passion is fizzling. I have wanted to be a teacher since I was in second grade myself. It's cliche, but it's true. I held school for all the neighborhood kids on my front porch on the weekends and during the summer, complete with a whiteboard easel I begged my parents for, printed worksheets I somehow discovered for free online, and yes, assigned homework I fully expected to be completed by the next day. Everyone who knew me knew I wanted to be a teacher, which of course meant they shared their opinions with me, often unsolicited. I heard all the cautionary tales about how hard it would be, how little I would make, and the thick skin I would need to grow if I truly wanted to make my dream a reality. I developed a list of go-to responses I would unconsciously recite any time I faced these warnings. My favorites were, "I'm in it for the outcome, not the income," and "teaching is a calling, not a profession," which I often quoted with a smile wrapped so far around my face the corners of my mouth practically met behind my head. I invited every horror story I heard about teaching as a challenge because I thought my work ethic and passion for the profession were unmatched. I sincerely believed I would be an anomaly and thrive as a first-year teacher. But as you can already tell, that wasn't the case. Setting expectations. One of the first things you hear echoed in your preparation to become a teacher is setting expectations for your students. So, I want to do the same for this book. If you're looking for a manual on how to be the perfect teacher in every situation, I'm sorry to say this book isn't that. And if you ever find that book, please send it my way because I'd love to know how it's done. I don't have all the answers for you as much as I wish I did. In fact, I'm convinced anyone who tries to persuade you that they have all the answers is lying because we are all just trying to figure out this thing called life, which came with no instruction manual. I can't give you a blueprint for how to navigate from the first day of school until the last day of school without any road bumps. I can't give you the secret recipe for eliminating every behavior problem in your classroom at any given time. I can't give you a formula to make sure every lesson plan flows seamlessly when you actually teach it to your students. Before we get any further into this, I want to make it extremely clear that I am not an expert, not even close. I taught second grade and fourth grade for 7 years before transitioning to a role supporting teachers. So, I don't have the most experience, the deepest knowledge, or the biggest resume in the field of education. And I'm not going to pretend I do. But what I can offer you is my unique perspective. Over the course of my teaching career, I documented a majority of my journey online and shared my experiences with the world almost like a virtual diary. I was able to capture the highs, the lows, and everything in between, which allowed me to reflect on my practice and grow in ways I never could have otherwise. I've made a lot of mistakes as a teacher, some of which you will learn about in this book, and some of which I'm still too embarrassed to think about, let alone write about. But through those mistakes, I've learned, and that is the most powerful thing we can do as human beings. In this book, I want to share my imperfect story, my vulnerable experiences, and the hard lessons I learned to help you realize you aren't alone, but also help you avoid making the same mistakes I did. When you enter your own classroom for the first time after college, you feel like your dreams are somehow coming true and simultaneously being crushed at the same time because you aren't as prepared as you hoped you would be. You're excited and eager, but also confused, overwhelmed, and scared. That's where this book comes in. In the upcoming chapters, I'm going to share the 10 lessons I never learned in college that played the biggest role in my growth as a teacher and can help you provide first-class teaching to not only your first class, but every class that is lucky enough to have you as their teacher. Teaching is incredibly rewarding, but also incredibly challenging. So hopefully this book can make it just a little bit easier for you. Chapter 1. Practice What You Teach. Back to school night is the teacher equivalent of trying to capture the perfect family photo. If you've never experienced the chaos that is family portrait taking, let me explain. First, everyone gets dressed in matching or at least coordinating outfits, but it is almost guaranteed that at least one of them gets stained, ripped, or wrinkled before the picture gets taken. Then, all the family members get arranged in a Tetris-like format that allows every face to be seen, as long as no one moves even half an inch in any direction. Finally, you take a few dozen shots in an attempt to have a single picture in which everyone is smiling. Bonus points are awarded if the tripod falls over halfway through or the photographer makes a small child cry, neither of which are very difficult to achieve. Back to school night is basically that same experience, but in a classroom. Leading up to the event, several hours are spent cleaning the classroom, displaying student work samples, and shoving messes into closets, only to be rediscovered at the end of the school year. The teacher puts on his or her favorite outfit, which gets drenched in sweat before anyone arrives, partially from nerves and partially from frantically running around the classroom in preparation. The grand finale is when families visit the school and the teacher repeats the same spiel about the curriculum and classroom routines, while students and their siblings entertain themselves using any means possible. In other words, it's a complete and utter hot mess. Back to school night is stressful, overwhelming, and yes, very sweaty. Despite knowing this, you can't help but be optimistic each year that with a little more preparation and effort, the event can run smoothly. After a few years of teaching and many failed attempts, I finally had a system down for back-to-school night. I had a plastic container packed with all the printed signs I displayed around my classroom to guide families around the stations, a digital slideshow with all the answers to the most frequently asked questions I would get from families, and a table where I would set up all the snacks. I quickly learned that snacks make everything more tolerable, including back-to-school night. My team teacher, Lauren, and I would stay after school and spend about 2 hours hanging student crafts that had been assembled during the first week of school on pieces of yarn, strung across the hallway in a crisscross design. Lauren was almost 6 feet tall, so she had no trouble reaching the ceiling, and I was a pro at organizing the papers in a colorful pattern to create that wow effect as you walked down the hallway. We truly made a great pair. During my fifth year of teaching, we decided to up our game and add a banner to the hallway because we had a little extra time to spare. Families would start coming into the school in less than an hour, but we were already changed into our fancy outfits and had touched up our hair and makeup. Back to school night always took place after a full day of teaching, and it showed. So both these steps were definitely a necessity. Lauren and I were sprawled out on the hallway floor with a large piece of colored butcher paper, markers, scissors, and glue sticks, when suddenly the fire alarm began echoing through the hallways. At that very instant, you could hear the teachers who were still at school groaning at the annoying piercing sound, but showing absolutely no urgency to vacate the building, ourselves included. We automatically assumed the alarm was being tested, so we chose to ignore it and continue preparing for our big night. We resumed decorating our banner until we heard the custodians conversing over the walkie-talkies about a strange smell. "Wait, did you hear what they said?" We could only make out a few words through the blaring alarm, but gas and fire department were definitely included. That's when it dawned on us. The fire alarm was sounding for a suspected gas leak in the school, which meant we did need to evacuate. We popped up off the floor, grabbed our heels, which had been tossed aside while working on the banner, and started sprinting to the front entrance of the school barefoot. The fourth grade wing was located in the back corner of the school, so we had a lot of ground to cover. Along the way, we were shouting at the top of our lungs to all the teachers in the building to get their attention. "This isn't a drill. You have to get out. There's a gas leak. We're evacuating. We repeat, this is not a drill." Teachers began flooding out of the classrooms, carrying their phones, teacher bags, and half-eaten microwaved dinners. By the time we got to the front of the school, we had an entire herd of frantic teachers jogging behind us, out of breath and profusely sweating. It's always been a running joke, pun intended, that teaching was our form of cardio, but clearly, sprinting through the school hallways in one of the hottest days of the year is actual cardio. We got to the parking lot where our principal, assistant principal, and custodians were casually standing, and the ringing of the fire alarm was finally muffled enough to have a normal conversation. Lauren and I proudly announced to our administrators that we ran from the fourth grade hall and alerted everyone along the way that we needed to evacuate. We felt like heroes. But our triumphant story was met with a confused look on their faces. "Wait, why did you come all the way to the front of the school? Why didn't you just go out of the doors in the fourth grade hall?" Lauren and I looked at each other and immediately broke out into laughter. We teach our students every single year how to handle an evacuation when the fire alarm goes off. And yet, when an opportunity presented itself to practice what we preach to our students, we completely failed. Ask any student, and you will hear the same list of steps repeated. Leave behind all your belongings, don't run, quietly exit the classroom, and leave the school through the closest set of doors. What did we do when the fire alarm went off? We took items with us, screamed and yelled while running through the hallways, and took the absolute farthest route possible to exit the building. We basically put on a show of exactly what not to do when the fire alarm goes off. It was embarrassing, but honestly, not surprising. Never stop being a student. We all have experienced being a student, whether it was in school growing up, while earning a degree, or trying to learn a new hobby or skill. We've all been in student mode. When student mode is activated, you're a sponge, absorbing as much information and experience as you can. You accept the fact that you're an amateur and perfection isn't expected, or even possible, because you're still learning. You embrace trying new things, making mistakes, and ultimately, growing through the process. But when you graduate college and step into your own classroom for the first time, it feels as though a switch has been flipped. Suddenly, student mode has been turned off and teacher mode has been turned on. When teacher mode is activated, you're suddenly thrust from the passenger seat of the classroom to the driver's seat. You gain control, which comes with added responsibilities related to both your performance as the teacher and the performance of the students sitting before you. All your education and training has supposedly prepared you for this, so the transition should be seamless. But the activation of teacher mode comes with a lot of self-imposed and societal expectations. As a teacher, you are now a professional and a role model, which means you suddenly feel the pressure to perform at a higher standard. Especially when you have a room full of students looking to you for guidance, you feel like you're expected to have the answer to every question, a solution for every problem, and mistakes have to be avoided at all costs. This pressure, whether it's externally or internally imposed, is very real and very heavy. But the expectation to be perfect is incredibly unrealistic. Teaching is rooted in people, and people are complicated. Over the course of your career, you are going to face difficult circumstances that no amount of education or training could ever prepare you for. You will have students who come to you with heartbreaking stories and less than ideal home lives that take an emotional toll. You will be faced with the moral dilemma of teaching curriculums with fidelity that you know are outdated and don't meet the needs of your students. You will have to manage challenging behaviors with care, caution, and strategic choices. Every single day in your classroom, you will make hundreds of split-second decisions. The bad news? You are going to get things wrong along the way. It's unavoidable. But the good news is, these moments of imperfection are the most powerful moments we have as teachers to act as positive role models for our students. A strong role model isn't perfect. A strong role model leads others by continuously showing up as the best version of themselves. Role models encourage growth in others by setting an example of humility, self-reflection, willingness to change, and responsibility. Ironically, these are the same qualities we expect from our students. We want them to make mistakes, evaluate their progress, make adjustments, and accept responsibility for their actions. Instead of seeking perfection, we just want students to always show up as their best selves. These expectations are realistic and attainable, which sets students up for success. But when it comes to the expectations we place on ourselves as teachers, we don't hold ourselves to the same standard. We feel embarrassed when we make mistakes and try to mask them from others. Refuse to ask questions in moments of uncertainty to avoid appearing ignorant, and evade help from others in fear of judgment and scrutiny of our abilities. The same way our students look up to us for guidance, we need to look to them for inspiration as they continuously model the qualities necessary to grow and improve as individuals. To be a great teacher, you have to practice what you preach, or in this case, teach. Revamp your expectations. Close your eyes and visualize your idea of the perfect student. How do they act in class? What is their mindset toward learning? How do they collaborate with others? Think about their attitude, behavior, actions, and effort, and consider how these elements positively impact their experience as a learner. You might be thinking of a student who walks into your classroom every day with a smile and all the necessary materials, maybe including a coffee for you, but let's not get too greedy, which shows a positive attitude and an eagerness to learn. Every time you ask a question, this student's hand immediately shoots up in the air because he or she is engaged in the lesson and wants to participate. The student you're picturing might be flexible with trying new things, takes risks, and is willing to make mistakes. When you offer feedback, he or she reflects and adapts in order to make improvements and avoid repeating the same mistakes in the future. This student works well with others, enjoys collaborating to gain new perspectives, and values what others have to offer. This sounds dreamy, doesn't it? Let's come back to reality for a second. Obviously, students seldom possess all of these incredible qualities. Some students are always engaged in the lesson, but struggle to accept feedback or redirection, while other students are willing to take risks and make mistakes, but every group collaboration results in arguments. Just like every other human being, students are imperfect and have flaws, which is to be expected because we've already established that perfection isn't the goal. But as you reflect on the ideal qualities you look for in your students, it is important to be honest with yourself about how many of the qualities you personally possess and consistently practice as a teacher. If roles were reversed, would you be satisfied with your attitude, behavior, actions, and effort? My first year of teaching coincided with training for my fourth marathon. Don't worry, I already know how crazy I was. While I was constantly exhausted, both physically and mentally, from all the hours I was working as a teacher, paired with all the miles I was running in training, this combination presented me with ample time to think and reflect on my practice. I started every run listening to a murder mystery podcast. I mean, what else would you listen to while running through the woods by yourself? But my racing thoughts always forced me to pause halfway through. I would think about everything from seating arrangements to lesson modifications, and never failed to come up with my best ideas during my long runs. The more I reflected on the struggles I was experiencing as a first-year teacher, the more I realized my actions weren't in alignment with the teacher I wanted to be. I was beyond frustrated that some of my students never appeared engaged in my lessons. Yet, I scrolled on my phone and chatted with my coworkers during the last staff meeting. I found it disappointing when a student was confused on an assignment and chose not to ask questions for clarification. But I stayed quiet during collaborative planning meetings when I didn't understand a component of the curriculum. I felt defeated when I couldn't get my students to cooperate while completing group work. Yet, I never reached out to my team teachers to collaborate on a lesson because I preferred to work alone. In summary, I was a hypocrite. I realized if I was going to expect these characteristics from my students, I had to hold myself accountable and continue practicing these same qualities in my new role as teacher. Practicing what you teach means placing the same expectations on yourself that you place on your students. Be humble. If you expect your students to be honest and admit when they make mistakes, you have to assume the same humility. This includes apologizing to your students if you lose your temper on a particularly stressful day, or make an error while teaching a lesson, apologizing to families if you forget to return a phone call.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.